Well, praise the Lord, everyone. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Look who's starting this out today. Did I cut that off? Yeah. Look who's starting this out today, Pastor Leslie. Glory to God. Happy Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day to y'all. Oh, my God. It's Mother's Day. It's a day that we're going to be real spoiled, ladies. We're going to be real spoiled. We want to say from Pastor and myself and the New Beginnings family, want to say Happy Mother's Day to all of our Facebook and New Beginnings family. We want to say happy birthday to our visitors who are visiting on the site as well. Today, we want to say Happy Mother's Day. I tell you what, mothers are special. Mothers, they said the hand that rocks the cradle rules the world. And so we know how important mothers are. And I want to say Happy Mother's Day to all of you. We love you and we appreciate you. And we pray that your Mother's Day is just filled with love, laughter, and blessings. And so I want to say just as a personal thing, Happy Mother's Day to my mom. You are the best, Mama Hughes. I love you, and I'm so thankful for you. My mom will be turning this year. She'll be turning 82 years old, 82 and looking good and still sassy. Mom, you something else with yourself. You sure setting the standard for me and Melissa and the rest of your children, the rest of your daughters and granddaughters in the name of Jesus. And also want to say happy Mother's Day to my Melissa, our sweet honeybee. We call her our honeybee. Happy Mother's Day. You are an awesome mother. We're so proud of you. And we want to say happy Mother's Day to you as well. And so I'm praying that I'll be able to get all that the Lord has given me to give to you all today in Jesus' name. So y'all put on your Holy Ghost seatbelts and let's get ready to be blessed and see what God would say to us today. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we praise you and we thank you for this wonderful and blessed day, the day that you have made. We're rejoicing and so glad in it. Lord, we're thankful. We're thankful for our mothers, be they with you already or still with us. We're grateful. We're grateful for the nurturing and the love and the character that they formed on the inside of us, the examples that they set before us, the legacy that they have given us to continue. Lord, we're thankful. And so, Lord, as we get into your word and go and look at what thus saith the Lord, we thank you that we honor you, Lord. Because of you, we can be great mothers. We can be great sisters, great daughters, great women, great wives, because our relationship with you. And so, Lord, as we gleam into the word and sit together, growing up in the things of God, I thank you that the Holy Spirit is in charge, that he is speaking through me. I yield myself. Do whatever you see fit, Lord, today in our lives, as we grow up in the things of God and be all that you've called us to be. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
And so, today, the Lord has led me to speak on, oh, I guess I put this behind here. The Lord has led me to speak on Mary of Bethany. Mary of Bethany. There's so many examples from Mary of Bethany. Now, you might say, who, Mary of Bethany? Well, there's a lot of Marys in the Bible. Of course, Jesus' mother's name was Mary. And then you had Mary Magdalene, who was possessed with demons. And then you have this Mary of Bethany. This Mary of Bethany, who you might say, well, who was that? Now, if you have your Bibles, turn to Luke chapter 10. Luke chapter 10. And we're going to begin reading at verse 38. We're going to begin to read and dissect at verse 38. So I'm going to be going back and forth with what I'm saying as I'm reading, okay? For the sake of time. Now, you might say, who was Mary? Well, Mary, she was from a little town about 2 miles outside of Jerusalem, which was called Bethany. That's why they called her Mary of Bethany. You know, when you got a lot of one people that have the same name, sometimes we have a tendency to name them by where they're from. Like, for example, I had 3 grandfathers, 3 grandmamas, because I had my natural one, and then we had 1 step. And so we would call my grandma and granddaddy that lived in Pennsylvania, Grandma and Granddaddy Pennsylvania. And we would call my grandma and granddaddy that lived on the east side, Grandma and Granddaddy East Side. And then the one that then the one granddaddy, we just called him Granddaddy Lipscomb. And so so we had you know, we had 3 granddaddies, 2 grandmamas actually. And so sometimes you're identified when you have so many with the same name by where you come from. So this is the Mary of Bethany. Now Mary was the sister of Martha and Lazarus. And of course, we remember Lazarus. We're going to talk a little bit about that. So here is Mary, Martha, and Lazarus. And so let's read from Luke chapter 10 and verse 38. It says, "Now it came to pass as they went that he entered into a certain village." And that certain village, of course, was Bethany. "And a certain woman named Martha received him into her house." So here, the story starts where we find Martha. Now this Martha is a great housekeeper. She's a great homemaker. Martha received him into their house. Can you imagine Martha? Here she is. Jesus is coming to the house. She is the ultimate. She's the ultimate hostess. She's the ultimate homemaker. So she was the perfect hostess. She was the ancient day Martha Stewart and Betty Crocker rolled up into one. She prided herself on taking care of people and having everything right. How many women can identify with that? How many Marthas do we have out there who really pride ourselves on our home being just right? Our home being just right, especially if somebody important is coming to our house. She prided herself on taking care of people and having everything done right. You know, she understood the etiquettes and how to welcome people, how things are supposed to look, how things are supposed to be done. She loved to hear how good everything was and how well she did, how good everything tasted. Now, I like to cook. And when I cook, I like to cook for a lot of people. And when I cook for a lot of people, I like them to tell me it tastes good. Don't be coming over here eating my food and you ain't said it don't taste good, or you haven't said anything about where it tastes. Now, I want to hear that it tastes good. Oh, we want to hear, when we just spend so much time in our home fixing it up, we want people to come in and say it looks good. So I think we all got a little Martha in us, don't you? She loved to hear how good everything was and how well she did and how good it tasted. She loved to entertain people. Now, I tell you, I do. I like to entertain people. I like making a good atmosphere. I like for people to feel welcome in my home and we laugh and enjoy each other. I like a good atmosphere in the home. Now, can you imagine how anxious she was how anxious she was feeling when she found out Jesus was coming? Jesus, the master, is coming to my house. How she wanted everything to be in order. This is Martha. How she wanted everything to be in order. And everything to be just right. Can y'all identify, ladies, with Martha? Here's Jesus coming. She's anxious. Everything got to be right. Everything got to be in order. She was very concerned about how things looked, tasted, how everything, the atmosphere, everything of her home was. And that's understandable. You got the master coming to your house. And then here's Mary. What does it say in verse 39? And she had a sister called Mary, which sat at the feet of Jesus and heard his word. So here she had Mary, her sister, who looks like she would be helping her. But can you imagine Mary? Here's Mary, unconcerned about the hoopla of getting the house ready for the master. Unconcerned about how it looked, how everything was going to taste, how all that kind of stuff. Can you imagine Mary when she heard about Jesus coming, that all she wanted to do was sit at his feet and hear him speak? Here you got two sisters. She wanted to hear. Here's Mary. She could care less about how the house looked and what the food was being served and how it tasted. She just wanted an experience with God, sitting at the master's feet. So here you have two perspectives. You have two women. Both of them was doing what was most important to them. What was most important to Martha was being the perfect hostess. What was most important to Mary was having an experience with God. Oh. And so it goes on to read. But Martha was cumbered about much serving and came to him and said, Lord, dost thou care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Bid her therefore that she help me. So here she, now she telling on her. I can imagine her looking over there Mary's sitting at the master's feet. She's sitting over there sitting at the master's feet, not helping her, unconcerned. You know, when we're concerned about stuff, we want everybody to be concerned. We want everybody to be all in the uproar. Have you ever been cleaning your house and your house is all tore up and ain't nobody caring? Now, what in the world are you doing, girl? Get up. Help me. And here, she probably was thinking, this girl is lazy. She gonna sit up there at the master's feet? She was coming about with much serving and came to tell on him. Now look, she says, dost thou not care that my sister hath left me to serve alone? Bid her therefore that she help me. So here's Martha asking Jesus a question. And her question was in the form of rebuking him. She gonna rebuke the master. Think about that. She got so wired up, so upset, so tore up about this thing that she gonna go to the master and rebuke him because he ain't told her to get up and help her. Because she valued working over her time with the Lord, she became offended. Let me say that again. She valued working over her time with the Lord. I hope we can identify ourselves here. How often have we valued working on something over our spending time with the Lord? You see, because doing that good thing, and it was a good thing, but not the right thing, will carry you to a place of offense. You could be doing something good. You could be doing something that's really, really good, but it's not right for right now. It's right now is the time to sit at the master's feet. And she got offended. She got offended at Jesus because he didn't tell her to get up. Here's Mary sitting at the feet of Jesus. Now, she's the only woman in there sitting at his feet. She ain't even supposed to be in there. And here she is sitting at his feet. Now, you know, the question she asked Jesus was more than her words were saying. Let me y'all understand that. The question she said, why don't you tell her to come and help me? But see, that was a loaded question. How many times, women, we have loaded questions? We'll say something, but it's a whole lot more behind what we're saying. There's a whole lot more behind what we're saying. You know, women do that a lot. You see, Martha wanted to be recognized for her hard work. At the same time, she was trying to point out the flaws in her sister in her sight. In her sight, these were flaws to her. I'm going to point her out. I'm going to put her on shame show. I'm going to make sure they see that I'm the hard worker and she lazy. How dare Mary sit here amongst these men at the feet of Jesus? How dare she do that? I'm going to point out her flaws. See, that's what offense will do. Offense will cause you to point out flaws in others, to blame others, to think bad about others. Martha was distracted. I like what Pastor always says. He says, if Satan can't get you with destruction, he'll get you with distraction. Let me say that again. If Satan can't get you with destruction, he'll get you with distraction. You know, all those things that you think you got to get done, all those good things that you think you got to do, all those. But is it the right thing at the right time? Now, here it says Jesus answered, and Jesus answered and said unto her, Martha, Martha, thou art careful and troubled about many things. In other words, the question you asking me is a loaded question. You really got a lot behind that. But let me tell you this. But one thing is needful, and Mary have chosen that good part, which shall not be taken away from her. And so he said, you know what? You're concerned. You're upset about a lot of things. Yeah, that's a loaded question, what you say in there. You what's behind that question was it was more than just your words, but it was your attitude. It was the offense behind it. It was you trying to pump yourself up over your sister. It was you doing the good thing, but not the right thing. Let me just tell you something. That question you're saying is more than just a question. And then the master took up for Mary. He said, Mary have chosen that good part, which shall not be taken from her. Right. That one thing that would never be taken from her. And we have to understand that there are times there's a time for everything. And when the Spirit of God is moving and the Word of God is being taught, we need to stop everything and sit down and listen. I'm going to say it again. When the Spirit of God is moving and the Word of God is being taught, we need to stop everything and sit down and listen. Now you have the opportunity to be in your home and get the Word piped into your home, your beautiful place where you live. Now you need to stop doing everything that you're doing. Sit down and get the Word. These times, these experiences are special. And they'll equip you for what is to come, bringing you closer to Him. Our relationship with God, it will dictate everything else. And so here she was, sitting at the Master's feet, formulating her relationship, having an experience with God. Now let's go on to the book of John. John chapter 11 and verses 1 through 46, it talks about Lazarus' death and his resurrection. Now I'm going to summarize up to verse 28 so that you can get what was going on. And so Jesus got word that Lazarus was sick. Now Lazarus is one of his good friends. And so Jesus and his sisters had sent word to him, Lazarus sick, come and heal him before he died. But Jesus took his time. He took his time. And they was like, Master, you know, you got word that your friend, he's sick. He could die. He said, he's sleeping. And so they say, well, if he's sleep, that's a good thing. We could just go and wake him up. He said, no, Lazarus is dead. Jesus understood Lazarus had died while he was out there. And so here, when he got close to Bethany, when he got close to where Lazarus was, his sisters, Martha ran to him and said, Lord, if you had been here, my brother had not died. And he said, Lord, girl, in other words, don't you know who you're talking to? I'm the resurrection. She said, I know in those days, we going to all get up. He said, no, I'm the resurrection right now, in other words. And so she, okay, all righty. And so then she goes and sends word to her sister, Mary. Now let's pick up at verse 28. And when she had said, she went her way and called Mary, her sister, secretly saying, the master has come and calleth for you. As soon as she had heard that, Mary, she rose up quickly and came unto him. Now, Jesus was not yet come into the town, but was in the place where Martha met him. And the Jesus then, which were with her in the house, the Jews then, which were with her in the house and comforted her, when they saw Mary, that she rose up hastily and went out, followed her, saying, she goeth unto the grave to weep there. You know what? Let me just stop right there. You know, when stuff go down, and it's a bad situation. You got people who are professional mourners, professional criers that will come and cry with you, that'll come and be there with you. Well, this is who was with Mary at the time. They were comforting her. They was there crying with her. And that's beautiful, though. And then when Mary was come where, Jesus was, she saw him. So then Mary, she wasn't going to the grave. She was going to see Jesus. And when she saw him, she what? Fell down at his feet. Wait a minute.
Yeah.
Fell down at his feet. This This is the same place where she had that experience with God. This is the same place where she began to get to know him. This is the same place where she sensed him and heard his word, where her life was revolutionized. She fell at his feet. See, when we're going through things, oftentimes we need to go back to where we met him. In other words, right here, Lord, I remember where you touched me, where you first touched me. I remember, we need to think back and to remember when we first met him, how our life was revolutionized. When we first felt the anointing envelop us, when we first sensed the love of God, when we're going through things, remember that time, that special time. Now, this is an experience that will not be taken from you. This is an experience that will cause you to be able to get through what you got to get through. She fell down at his feet. Now, you didn't see Martha fall down at his feet. No, sir. But the first thing that Mary did was she went there where she first met him, where she first felt that anointing, saying unto him, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. So here she is. She's speaking to him about her heart. What's going on in her heart? What, if you had been here, I know you would have healed my brother. This would not have happened. How many times have we gotten and we remember that anointing? Remember what God has done for us. And it's gotten so bad out there till we say to the Lord, Lord, if you had come in time, I wouldn't have lost that. This would not have happened to me. This would not have gone down that way. This would not have happened. When Jesus therefore saw, verse 33, when Jesus therefore saw her weeping, there's a reason why every word in the Bible means something. Why is it telling us that Jesus is recognizing her weeping? And the Jews also weeping, which came with her. He groaned in his spirit and was troubled and said, where have you laid him? Yeah. They said unto him, Lord, come and see. Shortest verse in the Bible. Jesus wept. Now, Jesus is the resurrection. He's the answer. Why are you weeping? Why are you weeping? Why are you groaning in your spirit, Lord, for over this? You're going to correct this. Well, listen to me there. Jesus, this is a perspective, and there's all kinds of perspectives that you can get from this. But this, let's look at this perspective. Jesus groaned in his spirit. See, we have a high priest who is touched with the feelings of our infirmities. He wants you to know that he knows what you feel like. He knows how that hurts you. He knows your pain and your suffering. See, it touches the Lord's heart when we are hurting, even though he's the answer to our hurt. Oh, that might have flew over some of y'all's heads. You see, it touches the Lord's heart when we are hurting, even though he's the answer to our hurt. See, you might have the remedy. Let me give you an example. You might have a remedy to your child's pain. You might have the answer to your child's pain, but it hurts you to see them hurt.
That's right.
Yes, it does. You see, it hurts you to see him hurt. See, it's not just good enough that you can solve the problem, but do you understand my hurt? Oh, see, we ministers, sometimes we miss that. We're giving out answers and we're giving out answers, but we're not recognizing the hurt and the pain that the people are going through.
Right.
You see, it the healing is so much better. The love is so much more real received when you recognize that I'm hurting. When you recognize that I'm in pain, even when you have the answer. It said here, Jesus wept. Jesus identified with Mary and the Jews that were weeping for him. Even though he is the resurrection, and he knew, as the story goes on, that he was going to get him up. I believe that in this scripture here, this passage of scripture, is where you find most ardently, one of the biggest examples of the Lord identifying with our pain, identifying with our suffering.
Oh yeah.
You see, if you hit me in the head, you might say you're sorry, but doggone, recognize it hurt me when you did it. You see what I'm saying? Your sorry ain't gonna help me right now. I need you to know that hurt. It's a good lesson for ministers to understand. Sometimes we need to slow ourselves down and hear the cries of the people. Identify with the cries of the people while we apply the balm of Gilead, the ointment, to their wounds. The Bible tells us that we are to laugh together. We're to sing together, love together. We're to identify with one another. Even though I might have the money, the answer, I still need to identify with you and recognize your pain. And so here's Mary that fell at the feet of Jesus again, coming into the home stretch in John chapter 12 in verse 1. It says, then Jesus, 6 days before the Passover, came to Bethany. So this is 6 days before the time when Jesus is actually going to be crucified. And Jesus, 6 days before the Passover, came to Bethany, where Lazarus was, which had been dead, whom he raised from the dead. There they made a supper. And what was Martha doing? Martha served. That tells me something. That tells me that you can see the experience that your sister or your brother might have with God. But if you don't have a mind to change, you won't change.
That's true.
Your brother just got raised up from the dead. And you still serving. Instead of sitting at his feet, getting the word of God. But Lazarus was one that sat at the table with him.
Yeah.
Then took Mary. Oh my God.
There it is.
Mary. Can you imagine Mary looking at Jesus? He came to her house again. Oh my God. Jesus came to our house again. Let me ask, one, I wonder what you gonna do when Jesus come to your house. Or are you gonna be busy trying to make yourself look good and doing all this kind of stuff? And,
wow.
and you know how when we go to the house of God, we gotta have the right suit on, the right clothes on. We gotta say it right, dot our I's and dot my hair. I can't go into them because my hair is not done, man. Instead of just going to have an experience with God. Then took Mary a pound of ointment of spikenard, very costly, and anointed, here she back there again, the feet of Jesus, and wiped his feet with her hair, and the house was filled with the odor of the ointment. Let's break this down. So then took, her sister was still serving. And then took Mary a pound of ointment of spikenard. Now this was, it said it was very costly. So she took the most precious thing she had. Can you imagine her looking at Jesus and how she remembered that experience the first time when she sat at his feet, and then when she went to his feet again when she was in the most distressed time of her life, and how Jesus raised her brother up from the dead, how he showed her that he is the resurrection in real time. Can you imagine her remembering that special place? So much so that she took the most precious thing that she had. Said it's very costly. Now others said it was the alabaster box, and she didn't even take time to open it properly. She just broke it. And the others' translation said she anointed his head and his feet. Good God Almighty. You see, this feet thing was a place where she had an experience of God. My question to you, and trying not to run too fast, do you remember the first place where you had an experience with God?
Yes.
Do you remember his love enveloping you, where you just felt like you were shaking on the inside, where you cried and cried and cried and cried some more? You see, it says she wiped it with her hair, and other translations says with her tears. See, this was not orchestrated. This act, this sacrifice, this thing that she was doing for the Lord was not orchestrated. It was just raw and genuine. Oh my, underscore that. It was raw and genuine. It was not choreographed. It was raw and genuine. See, those raw, uncoordinated times are the most anointed. Because, see, you're not coming trying to fix yourself up and look this way and doing things proper. It's more raw. It's more savage. It's more uncoordinated. It's more primal. It's more primal. See, that's the thing. We have gotten so sophisticated till we lost the primal times. You remember when the Lord first came to you? How you cried and you snotted, and you didn't care what folks looked like. You didn't care what folks thought about you. You was having an experience with God. And then you got sophisticated.
Yeah.
Then your sacrifices got more coordinated.
Yeah.
You remember the time when you would give God anything that you had? You know, I was thinking about it. I've been meditating on sacrifice for several years now. And sacrifice is almost a cuss word now in Christendom. Because we want everything to be known. We want everything to line up. We want everything to make sense. See, sacrifice, a real sacrifice don't make no sense. A real sacrifice costs you something. A real sacrifice is the one where you're all in. A real sacrifice is primal. It's raw. It's uncoordinated. It's genuine. And she took that and she anointed his feet, that place, and wiped his feet with her hair. My God, she didn't do like Martha would have did. Martha would have had towels lined up and all this. No, she just did it at that time. I'm here and this is all I got. Lord, I'm going to take my glory. See, the women hair is supposed to be the woman's glory. I'm going to take my hair and just wipe your feet and wash them with my tears. Another translation said her tears. And look what happened. It says that the house was filled with the odor and the anointing and the ointment of the ointment. The house was filled with the odor of the ointment. You see, when we come to God in this kind of manner, and it's sacrificial and it's primal and it's raw and genuine, oh, the smell of it in the nostrils of God. I like what they said about Cornelius. They said that his offering went up as a fragrance, a sweet fragrance to God. See, it creates an aroma in heaven. It fills the room. Can you see? Can you imagine the room being filled with the odor of her sacrifice? Good God Almighty.
That's good.
And how beautiful that was. You see, everybody ain't going to understand this kind of commitment. Everybody's not going to understand this kind of dedication, this kind of primalism, this rawness, this uncoordinated and genuine act. And so you see in verse 4, it says, "Then said one of the disciples, Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, which should betray him, why was not this ointment sold for 300 pence and given to the poor?" See, people will tell you, why are you sacrificing like that? Why are you getting before God like that? Why are you up early in the morning crying out before God? Why are you crying so much when you hear his name? Why are you bending your knees so much? Why are you doing all this kind of stuff? Don't you see all these other people need help right now? Can't you? But it's time for me to get at his feet. Now, other translations tell us that it wasn't just Judas that was saying this. Uh-oh. His other disciples thought this was a waste too. Uh-huh. So when you get before God, when you have an experience with God, don't look for a popularity contest. Don't look for people to pat you on the back and say you're doing a great thing. Don't look for people to affirm you. You're affirmed in him. When I'm crying before God and I'm spending time with him, I'm not looking around to see if it's okay with my husband and my kids and whoever else.
Come on now.
This is my time with him. This is my experience with him. This is me and him. This is that thing that will never be taken from me. Oh my God. Verse 6. Yeah. This he said, not that he cared for the poor. Of course he didn't. But because he was a thief and had a bag and bear that which was put within it. So he probably was thinking how much money he could have got off of it. his attitude wasn't even right. Verse 7. Then said Jesus, "Let her alone."
Leave her alone.
Woo! I remember my mother in the kitchen. Early in the morning, singing praises to God, then break out speaking in tongues. Her and the Lord's having a good time. My grandfather be like, "Shut up! Girl, you're waking up the whole house." But she kept going. And those times that I remember caused me to seek after the Holy Spirit like she had. Because I knew what she had was genuine. Yeah. I saw the raw act, the unorchestrated, uncoordinated sacrifices that she made. Oh my God.
Leave her alone.
Leave her alone. Against the day of my burying have she kept this. In other words, another translation says, "This she is preparing me for my burial." This is she. So here is, because she, Mary, sat at the feet of Jesus, she caught his heart.
Yeah.
And she picked up in the spirit that something is going on with my Lord that is monumental. Yeah. And she anointed his body, preparing it for his burial. Yeah, good God Almighty. Let me tell you something. When you sit at the feet of Jesus, he'll start giving you secrets. He'll start telling you what's to come. He'll start unfolding things to you that nobody else might know.
Yeah, I like that.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
He said, "For the poor always ye have with you, but me have not always."
Yeah, there it is.
So it's very important that we remember the time. Yeah. We remember what's going on.
Yeah.
You see, this was the second time that Jesus took up for Mary sitting at his feet. This is the second time he said, "Leave her alone." This is the second time he took up for her. Look at here. The first time was at her house when Martha was cumbered about much serving. The second time was this time. Jesus took up for her position, what she was doing. How many of y'all want Jesus to take up for y'all? You see, you may be wondering what got you through those tough times. Uh-huh. You see, but if it had not been for the Lord, you wouldn't have made it. You see, your survival in those tough times, how you survived, how you got through, was because you sat at the feet of Jesus. You see, sitting at the feet of Jesus prepares us for what's to come. Sitting at the feet of Jesus reminds us who he is. Sitting at the feet of Jesus gives us an inside track on what's going on. How many times have I heard tragedy that's happened to members of our household, members of our church, and even in our own life? And we think, oh my God, I don't know how I'm going to get through this. Oh my God, I don't know how I'm going to last. But then we remember when we sat at his feet. I remember not too long ago, I talked to the Lord like this, and I was just talking to the Lord, and I was kind of complaining and everything. And then the Lord said to me this. He said, what you going to do? You going to leave me? And I said, oh, Lord, no. I said, Lord, I would never leave you. Like Peter said when the 70 left Jesus and only 12 was left. I said, Lord, I would never leave you. I don't care what's going on. Where would I go? And then I said, Lord, I'll tell you this. I said, I will lay at your doorstep, curled up at your doorstep for as long as it takes for you to come and get me. Yes, I would. I would lay there as long as it takes. You see, because I understand the choice part. Understand that I got through the tough times of life because of my relationship with him, because I chose to sit at his feet. And when it comes time for the word to be ministered, when the Holy Spirit is moving, I'm sitting there attentive. I ain't trying to butter no biscuits and do all this other stuff. Man, I got to hear what thus saith the Lord.
Yes.
So choose the choice part. Choose the good part. This will never be taken from you.
Yeah.
Don't forsake those times ever.
Yeah.
Father, in the name of Jesus, we praise you and we thank you, Lord, for allowing us to sit at your feet.
Yes, thank you, Lord.
Oh my. Lord, we come. We come, Father, as we are. Just as we are. We come in our primal form, not sophisticated and trying to be something that we really ain't. And Lord, we thank you that at those times that you reveal yourself to us, that your glory envelops us. As we learn more and more about you. Thank you, Father, for allowing us to sit at your feet. In Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I'm going to let my husband come and do the altar call. And happy Mother's Day. But don't leave right now, because right now we're in the attitude of prayer. As people are making a decision to know him, to sit at his feet.
Perhaps there might be someone that don't know Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior. Hey, I love to pray with you today. Amen. Praise God. We'll talk more about what I'm wearing after the altar call. Amen. Praise God. My wife did an incredible job, and now we don't want to let this moment pass us by. This is the most important part of the sermon right now, and that is the altar call. If you're here and you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, hey, I would love to say a simple prayer with you today. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. And you can know that you know that it's going to be even a better Mother's Day for you. Because what good is Mother's Day if you don't know Jesus? What good is Mother's Day if you don't know Jesus? Oh, your Mother's Day will be a whole lot better by having received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. And in fact, you know what? Your mother, if she's still alive, and even if she's not, she'll be a whole lot happier if you knew Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. In fact, that's the greatest gift that you can give your mother. It's not buying her some clothes and giving her money and sending her on a trip and all that. Praise God for those things, but what's even greater than that is that you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and personal Savior. You know, the Bible says in Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and that thou shalt believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, said thou shalt be saved. Yeah. Verse 13 said, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So I wonder if that's you today. If that's you, I want to say a simple prayer with you today. I'm going to encourage you to follow along with me, and others as well, you can pray along with me. Say, dear Heavenly Father, I come to you today as humble as I know how. Lord, I'm tired of doing it my way. I'm ready to do it your way. So, Lord, I just thank you right now. I just heard in your word. You said if I confess with my mouth that Jesus is Lord, and if I believe in my heart that God has raised you from the dead on the third day, you said, Lord, I'll be born again. So right now, Lord, I confess with my mouth that Jesus is right now my Lord, Savior, and Master. And I believe in my heart that God raised you from the dead on the third day. Jesus, I accept you now as my Lord, Savior, and Master. Lord, do something great with my life. In Jesus' name. Amen. Praise the Lord. We're so excited for you in the name of Jesus. Glory to God. I tell you, Jesus is Lord. You know, the Bible says that the angels in heaven are rejoicing. They are rejoicing with you over just one person accepting Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. Amen. Praise God. Now, we want to get a book to you. Amen. Called Where Do I Go From Here? And we want to get this book to you. Now, there's some simple instructions for you. This book is going to really help to disciple you, grow you up, develop you, mentor you. Now, what you need to do is just go to our website at newbeginningclc.org. Go to our website at newbeginningclc.org, and you can get this book. And it's free of charge. You don't have to pay anything. Amen. Praise God. Great book here. Amen. So we'd like to say congratulations to you once again. Welcome to the family of God. Man, we are so happy for you in Jesus' name. This is the greatest gift that you can ever give to your mother, whether she is passed on or whether she's alive today. That's the greatest thing you can do for mom in the name of Jesus. Man, we're so excited for you. Man, congratulations in the name of Jesus. Amen. Praise God. Well, I trust that you guys enjoyed the word today. I tell you, I was sitting right there on the sofa, man, enjoying this word. Good word, good word. Yeah. Having a heart for God. And I especially like that part, leave her alone. Man, I kept on hearing that inside my spirit. Yes. You know, the part that she read during the end, leave that woman alone. Mm-hmm. Let her worship me. Let her anoint my body. Yes. Leave her alone. It's the same thing at church. You know, sometimes people be worshiping God and all that. Folks be looking at them like, it don't take all that. Now, I don't understand that. Like we just read in God's word, some folk were sitting there thinking, man, we could have sold that. We could have got some money out of off of sit down somewhere. Ain't nobody trying to get no money off of nothing. Yes. Glory to God. Leave her alone. You leave that woman alone. Leave that man alone. Let them worship me from their heart. Yes, and I like that word primal. Oh, man. Just authentic from the heart, you know, not made up and choreographed, just the overflow coming from the overflow of your heart. Yeah. Honey, you did an incredible job in the name of Jesus, girl. Girl, I like that message. Amen. Yeah. We ought to put that in book form. Amen. A real nice little mini book. Boy, that'd be great, wouldn't it? Amen. Praise God. So we thank God for our first lady. And of course, you know, I adorned her. On my right-hand side, you know, we got flowers for mom and balloons. We got clothes. Yes. We got all kinds of stuff for the first lady. And we're just so honored to have her as our first lady. Yes. She's a wonderful girl. She's my wife. She's everything. Amen. Jesus is being number one, but then my wife is number two. I just love her. She's my best friend. Yes. Leslie is everything to Kevin Wright, to her children, and to our members here at New Beginnings. And then, of course, let us not forget about our Facebook family. They're part of our church as well. Yes, they, Lord. Hey, they are members of our church.
Yeah.
I don't know. What do you call that, honey? Your Facebook church? Hey, what do you call that? I forget the name you call it, but yeah, Facebook church. I don't care. They don't live here, but they're in different states. And I'm going to tell you, they give to our ministry. They support our ministry. They do everything that our members do. That's right. And they just see us as their family. As their pastor, amen. They see you guys as their family.
Uh-huh.
Amen, praise God. So First Lady, we love you, and we adorn you with flowers and gifts and everything.
Yes.
And let me tell you, thank you guys for adorning her with telegrams, gifts, cards, yes, whatever you do for the First Lady.
Yes.
She's always thankful, amen.
Yes.
Praise God. Well, it's time to give. Amen, yes. Praise God. Yes. Woo, man, let me tell you. That giving will open up doors. What you need is wrapped up in your seat. I got a testimony for you guys. Not today. I got a real big one. I ain't going to tell you. I know y'all little minds is going. But because of our seed, a big door was open. And let me tell you, I'm going to leave it alone. I'm going to leave y'all alone because y'all minds go to ticketing can on. But your giving opens doors.
Yes, sir.
Your giving opens doors to greatness. Your giving opened doors to health and healing. Your giving opened doors to having favor with God as well as with man.
Yes.
Ooh, that's I'm going to do a teaching on that. There's something about your giving. And some of you have been believing God for a breakthrough, even down to your physical health.
Yes.
Or the favor of God, the mercy of
yes.
God.
Yes.
Giving. There's something in giving.
Yes.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. Yes. You know, in Malachi chapter 3, it said, bring ye all the tithes. It's something about your giving. I even think about Cornelius. He said that your giving and your prayers will go up before God. Your giving from the heart, genuine, primal giving. God loves a cheerful giver whose heart is in his giving. Amen. Praise God.
Yeah.
Now, if you're going to give today, of course, I believe everybody ought to give something. Amen. I don't care if it ain't nothing but a penny. It's not equal gifts, but equal commitment from the heart.
Yeah.
God is looking at you from your heart.
Mm-hmm.
There are three ways to give. Number one, through PayPal. And you can go to newbeginningsplurclc.org. You can give by way of PayPal, newbeginningsplurclc.org. Or you can go through Cash App, and that's at New Beginnings Plural CLC.
Yes.
Amen. You know, nowadays people give in all different kind of ways, so we make it available for people to be able to give. Amen. Or you can just simply just mail it in, and that's at P.O. Box 320-658. P.O. Box 320-658, and that's Flowood, Mississippi, 39232.
Yep.
Amen. 39232. Amen. Praise God. I mean, it's something about their giving. I've seen people get healed because of their giving. I've seen people receive favor with man, with corporations, with banks, with people they needed favor with their boss. I mean, it's something about, and that's why God chose giving.
Mm-hmm.
You can't get away from giving. Giving means everything. Amen. Praise God. Just like the woman, just like Mary, she gave of her heart.
Yeah.
Amen. She wasn't tipping God. That just rose up my spirit right there.
Yeah.
Mary didn't tip God. She gave everything from her heart. Genuine, from her heart. Amen. I just want to encourage you guys, and I just kind of feel led right there. Oh, man, just give from your heart. Oh, my goodness. Give hilariously.
Yeah.
Amen. Praise God. Not of necessity and grudgingly. No. Let it come from your heart. Overflow. I hear that word right now. Give from your heart, just like Mary. Overflow. Yeah. Spending time in the presence of God, the overflow will kick in. Amen. Praise God. And we just want to thank you guys, even up until this day, as we were going through the pandemic. Let me tell you, a lot of churches went out of business. A whole lot of them. We have talked with bankers who have to bail out churches.
But no, it didn't affect us. Why? Because we give from our heart. We give genuinely. Amen. Praise God. We got primal giving. We're giving from the heart, and God will bless that. Why? Because God loves a cheerful giver whose heart is in his giving. Amen. Bible says in Malachi chapter 3, bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in my house. Prove me now herewith. Here with what? Your tithes and offerings. If I will not open up the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing that you ain't got enough room to receive.
Yeah.
I mean, you know that there's more windows than doors. Yeah. Lord, you can come on, Lord. I got room for more. Why? Not for me, but to help other people. Right. And when you help other people, you get blessed in the process. Mm-hmm. But it's all about helping other people. Amen. Well, I trust that you've done all that you're going to do regarding our giving. Let's hold up our offering to our great high priest, the Lord Jesus Christ, and let us agree in faith. Father, we thank you in the name of Jesus. Once again, we do count it an honor and a privilege to give this day. And Lord, we thank you that as we give, you'll give back to us good measure, pressed down, shaking together, and running over so men get back to our bosom. And Lord, we thank you that as we give, it'll cause new beginnings to continue to enlarge its tents so that we can reach out to a lost and dying world. And Father, we thank you because we're tithers. We thank you as a church, even our church tithes, Lord. And we thank you that the benefits of a tither, oh Father, is divine favor with you as well as with man. We thank you that we see all our members' debts are canceled now. We thank you that doors are opening for them, Father. Father, we thank you for their investments as well, that they'll begin to double, quadruple. Thank you for a hundredfold return. So Father, we just thank you right now. Ministering spirits, go forth, cause our return to come unto us. For we believe that we receive a hundredfold return in this lifetime. Wealth and riches are being in our house. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Amen. Praise God.
Yes.
And you know, I keep on wanting to say, now you can receive the offering.
Yes.
Woo, that day coming, in-person service. I can't wait. Lord, have mercy.
Yes.
Woo, Jesus. Man, I'm so ready to go back to church. My God. CDC, 6-foot distancing. I don't care what it takes. I'm ready to go to church. Glory to God. And I trust that you all are too. People can go everywhere else. You're at restaurant. Piles of folk at Kroger's. What's that other place? Sam's Club. There's so many folk up in there. You can make a... Hey, I'm going to leave that movie alone right there. It's folk everywhere, man. Folk all in the street. At the malls. Why can't we go to church? They everywhere. I went out there looking to buy my wife some. It was so many folk piled up in there. And yet you can't go to church? Not. Man, we going to church. We just waiting on that open door. Amen. And it's coming real soon. Amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Don't forget, all of you that's graduating from high school, college, and trade school, please contact the church office. Again, all of you graduates from high school, college, and trade school, contact the church office, 601-613-9482. Amen. 613-9482. Amen. And again, happy Mother's Day to all of our Facebook and New Beginnings mothers. We thank you. And like I said, we have adorned our First Lady. Normally we do it at the church and we make a big thing out of it. Hey, it's pandemic season, whatever. We're going to always bless Mama and be in her corner. Mother's Day, amen. Now, you know, she said happy Mother's Day to all her mom and Melissa and all that. But, you know, this is the first year that my family and I won't have my mother. Amen. Praise God. And I'm telling you, man, we've been so busy, it just ain't kicked in on me yet. I'm going to just be honest with y'all. We've been out of town to conferences, and then we had to go see Mama. You guys, you know the story. It seemed like we've been out of town for 4 weeks straight.
Yeah, we've been.
And I really ain't even thought about Mama passing. I know she's passed on to glory. It just ain't kicked in yet, y'all. I mean, it's Mother's Day, and somehow I think my mama's still in Michigan. I ain't gonna lie to y'all.
Yeah.
I really still think that my mama's in Michigan. Mm. So it takes a while for that stuff to kick in, you know? And so the time will come when I'll really sit down and think, Mama, go. I know she gone. Y'all follow me, but it just ain't kicked in yet. But Mama was a trooper, amen. And I know Mama is rejoicing in heaven. And Mama, happy Mother's Day in heaven. Glory to God. Hallelujah. So, honey, is there anything else
you can think of? Yeah, and you know, my pastor is, you see what he got
on? Oh, yeah, I forgot about this right here.
Right there. What did that say?
I asked her, what do you want?
Real she said, mask.
Honey, I don't want a whole lot. Well, you know, I'm going to do something for her anyway. She said, I want a ribeye steak. So, I done fired the grill up. The grill is out there waiting. I marinated them steaks. So they've been marinating over 24 hours. And right after this, I'm going to fire the grill up. I'm going to do her some ribeye steaks.
This says so grill master. Grill master.
Oh, yeah.
The man.
Yeah, that's
the myth.
It. That's it right there.
The legend.
Glory to God. Man, we're so excited. And honey, happy Mother's Day. How about a kiss there, Mommy? Mm. Woo, that's the sweetest sucker in the world. Hey, man.
Yes, he
God
got
bless
a
y'all.
Outfits, y'all.
Oh, yeah. I love shopping for my wife. And I know when I went to get the outfit, the women all up in there, I felt funny, you know. I'm going to leave that thing alone. But I'm like, Gina, let me get this and get out of here, you know. honey, your favorite shop is
Lane Bryant.
I was in there and they. Women went, ooh, that man, boy, she got him trained. Oh, that's nice what he got.
Yeah, I nice
said, oh, Lord Jesus. Ooh, his wife got him all trained. I don't know what that means. Oh, y'all know I know what it means. Amen.
That is correct.
I am trained.
That is correct.
I am trained. Hey, I run the whole. Look, I'm in charge of my house. I'm in charge of my house. I run the vacuum cleaner. I run the washing machine. I run all that mess around.
All that.
We love y'all. All you mothers, happy Mother's Day, and have a wonderful day with you and your family. We love y'all. Have a wonderful day.